If you're feeling incredibly severe anxiety, you're not alone. You're not alone. And we will cover that, many other topics tonight at the Bliss Cafe, Bar, and Grill here as we spend our time wisely, right use of mind, right use of time. What we'll do here is an interesting format. We will have share some talk and some ideas, and then we'll show a video and comment on that. Maybe we'll take some breaks during the video and to comment, and I'll go back to it. Just kind of spend in the evening looking at the important. Featured tonight will be several videos. I will click on them now. And one having to do with sadhus, second with some scenery from the Texas oil fields, which is a little hard to see, and now the will be some pictures from Vanity Fair, some in the 19th century, some amazing caricatures, and so we will take a look at some of these videos. Now, the anxiety, and the timeline of how events are going to play out during this time. What is happening right now is exactly what I was shown long ago, back in 1998, about what is going to happen. And we're virtually almost there. To understand your anxiety, you have to understand that we're on the cusp of the whole situation coming to fruition. And because of that, the intensity suddenly gets ratcheted up. Situation that I've been in hit a peak intensity last night. I had a dream that was so intense I can't even talk about it this time. It was so devastating that my energy body, the energy that I have to move the body, wasn't there. It was almost like frozen. And I could barely get out of bed, could barely move. Almost felt like it was possible to move. Felt completely devastated, entirely devastated. And how I got through the day, I don't know, but it's just been an incredible time. Hardly can walk. I feel like I'm suddenly going to pass out and collapse. And it's all from that dream that I had, really, where, wow, it was just a terrible strain beyond belief, I'm telling you. So that's another indicator of what the times that we're in, because what I was shown in a dream that was incredibly intense back in 1998 about was the future, how it's going to go. And I was shown the 44th president of the United States is the one during this time. 44th president. I didn't know who it would be. I had no idea. But that 44th president of the United States would try to take guns away from the citizens of the U.S. Try to impose gun control. And that effort would fail. And the failure of that effort would so infuriate the behind-the-scenes power base of the president that instead of taking guns away from people, confiscating guns, they would start locking up the people with guns. They would actually start putting them into what's called re-education camps. And at that point, that's when the relocation takes place. Christians might call it the rapture, things like that. So, and also there would be a point reached in this effort to turn the tide and get Americans to surrender their guns that it would become so intense that we'd reach a point where we'd almost feel like we're going to die. The push is so intense. And that's what I experienced last night. I experienced a push so intense that it almost killed me. And that's exactly what I saw in the dream, experienced. And then at some point, America will say, no, we're not giving up our guns. And then the president would have to relent, but then his handlers would become absolutely enraged, absolutely furious. And they would then resort to, instead of taking guns away from people, they'd pay the people who have the guns, they'd start locking them up. So, we are rapidly heading in that direction. And therefore, the anxiety is peaking. We know that the whole situation is... See, the only thing standing in the way of the New World Order is the fact of American citizens, gun ownership by American citizens. That's what's standing in the way. So it is the most important stumbling block, and it's the one that they want to remove most assuredly. That's what they want. And the failure of that is something that just absolutely infuriates them. And that's where we're at. That's where we're at in world history. I mean, wake up and smell the roses, folks. We're here. We're here. Regardless of how you feel about any issue, we're not taking sides on issues at this point. And there's really no need to. It's just a historical fact that that's where we're at. We're at the point where there's an attempt to dearm the world. Now, of course, if you want to know what dearming, how that plays out, just go down to Mexico and find out how people feel down there and why they're all coming up to the United States. Why? Because it's safe up here. Why is it not safe down there? Because nobody has guns except the drug cartels and the police. And of course, the drug cartels have paid off the police, which is exactly what will happen if you confiscated guns from the U.S. citizens. It'll be turned into another Mexico. And there's people in little countries like Luxembourg and Belgium and places who don't understand that. They don't understand the fact that America has a lot of criminals in it, and that American citizens have a sense of safety because the criminals are at least have to think twice. We're down in Mexico, once they confiscated all the guns, dug them up, metal detectors, go house to house, take all the guns, and of course the ammo. They don't allow any ammo. And then, of course, the drug cartel people, they can walk into any house and do whatever they want to do. They're not slightest afraid of anybody because they paid off the police. So they just run completely rampant. Yeah, home invasion, no, nothing to stop them. Nobody will stand up to them. The press, they kill them. If the press talks about it, they kill them. If the politicians, they kill them. Just, so, nightmare. It's an absolute nightmare. So, the thing is that American citizens can keep the peace of the country themselves. Whereas, you see, the New World Order, what they want is they want chaos in the world. And they want the world to be plunged in such a state of criminality and chaos that the world will then turn to a one-world dictatorship. They'll voluntarily surrender their freedoms. Whereas Americans say, we don't need to do that. We can keep the peace just fine ourselves. Nobody's coming into our neighborhood, you know. So look out if anyone comes into our house, our neighborhood, et cetera, right? No way. So Americans say, we don't need a dictatorship. We don't need someone to protect us. We'll protect ourselves. But the New World Order, what it wants to do is people have no protection against the criminal elements and anarchy. And then people will go to them and say, we desperately need your protection. Protect us. And they'll have their global police force and all of this. And that's what they want. So they want Americans to surrender their guns. And it's not going to happen. So they'll go to Plan B, which is to imprison the Americans. Which is when what's called the tribulation period is on full blast, which is when there will be other options available, other directions to go in. So we're right at that time, so we're feeling the intensity. I felt an all-out assault on my psyche last night. A complete, total, all-out assault. An attempt to give me pause and bring about a state of uncertainty, a state of severe uncertainty, which then paralyzes your energy. So I was barely able to function today at all. I don't think I've ever experienced something quite like this. And I've been working through it, working through it, working through it. But that's the kind of paralysis of uncertainty that is being unleashed upon the world right now, where people feel that they're not able to function at all unless they go ahead and agree with the pressures that are being put upon them, saying, okay, we'll give up our gun. Here, take them. We just want to be able to function. The people are locked into this uncertainty. And the ability to work through that is not easy. I'm having a rough go of it. I believe I am working through it. But it's still quite tough. So the stakes are really big. The stakes are huge. The stakes are essentially freedom or slavery is what the stakes are. And ultimately, of course, bliss is freedom, is true freedom. But the freedom to consider bliss is protected, should be protected in the world, whereas the one world order doesn't give you that freedom at all. Freedom to fail is very important. Freedom to try, freedom to fail, freedom to use your time the way you want to use it. All these things are vitally important. So we're not machines. We are not machines. And the New World Order sees us as machines. It's a machine-based ideology, very much so. And, of course, machines don't need salvation, do they? Yet we do need salvation because we're suffering. So, incredible times we live in. Incredible times we live in. And not a joke, not a joke. What happened to me last night was no joke. And it's still ongoing. I mean, I'm on the edge of collapse, actually. From an energetic standpoint, from a standpoint of clarity and stuff, I'm okay. My mind is fine. It's my energy that the nervous system is in a verge of collapse because the pressure is being brought to bear severe. I mean, I've been pressured by the ego before, my idols before, but it was a short burst. It was a short burst. This one went on and on and on and on and on and on and on to just an unbelievable wrathful extent. Just extremely intense lobbying effort to turn me, you know, away from truth. So it was so intense that it just almost collapsed my nervous system. So if you're having struggles, you know, join the crowd right now. And yet we shall prevail, where we shall go towards ultimate freedom, which is bliss. Now, there are some in the world who have sort of typified this idea of freedom to consider bliss. And we can look at one of these movies, the Sadhu movie. Truth. Okay, there you go. So now is concurrent with time. That is the Maha Mantra that will calm you down. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. Because bliss is non-judgment. Now these sadhus, they're renunciates. They give up. They make a vow that they won't visit their families anymore. They don't marry. Don't have families, and they don't own property. They don't own personal property at all, and they belong to different groupings. One is a Shiva, and the other is, you tell me, Vishnu, maybe. They paint their faces, which show other sadhus and the public in general what allegiance they have, whether they follow the Vishnu or Shiva. Those are two of the basic ones. And they have their rituals and etc. But and they, of course, they don't cut their hair or their beards, basically speaking. And so they look like very exotic characters. But all this facial paint is colored ash, and they just put it on with a lot of times compact, maybe a little mirror. And they have the ashes. The ashes are readily available there, and they just paint their faces. And they smear ash on their bodies, and that accounts for their so exotic a look. But all these markings are just basic markings. Either there's horizontal lines on their forehead, or a V-shaped kind of vertical line with a red area in the middle. There's various decorations, but they're pretty standardized. Each person has a sort of unique presentation, and they tend to wander a lot. They tend to wander a lot. They don't have necessarily many fixed abodes. They go from place to place to place. They tend to smoke a lot of hashish, some of them, a lot of hashish, a lot of marijuana in their so-called rituals. And they pontificate. They're able to pontificate about stuff. Some of them wear beads. But they're just basically, they look eccentric, but they're just pretty much normal people like anyone else. It's just that their markings that they put on like this make them look very, what would you call, mystical and extraordinary and stuff. But it's not the case. It's not the case. If you actually end up talking with them, you see that they're intelligent. They can discuss. You realize that they're just like us, and they really are not as advanced as we'd hope they would be. Not at all. Not at all. It's a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle, and they learn the scriptures, and they're able to. It's like adherents of other religions. The adherents of other religions, are they really wise? Or they attend church, on a regular basis? Are they really, truly, they know the answers to life's greatest questions or not? The answer is no, they don't. And the sadhus is the same situation. They can give you a song and a dance, and they can talk scriptures and stay mouth profound stuff. And you think, oh, they got dreadlocks and long beard, oh, they must be so wise. No, that's got nothing, absolutely nothing to do with it. It just means that they don't cut their hair or cut their beard. Anyone can stop cutting their hair or beard and smear white ash on it. It doesn't mean anything. That's not to say that. See, there's a Vishnu, I think. It's the white V with a red area in the middle on the forehead there. And there's another one, variation on it. Okay. Just means they're followers of, I believe that would be Vishnu. And that's its horizontal lines would be Shiva. It could be the opposite. I'm not quite, I can't quite remember. So once you realize that the dreads and the beard and the face painting are just, that's just, it's just not cutting your hair or beard and then putting ash on your forehead to signify who do you follow. And then there's different sects have different markings, to identify them. And a lot of the sadhus actually were eventually, this started partly to protect temples in India from marauders. And they were really kind of like an army that monks that would protect the temples. A lot of the sadhus, the ones that go like for the Kumbh Mela and bathing in the Ganges, a lot of those are like warrior groups. They actually own a lot of land because of, from protecting the temples and fighting for various maharajas and kingdoms, etc. They got gifts of land, huge gifts of land, and so they're actually quite wealthy. And they also get money from donations, etc. So they're kind of like the Catholic Church in a lot of ways. Is they own a lot of land, a lot of donations, very wealthy actually. So of course these sadhus can give up everything and wander because they have so many temples, so many places to stay, and I imagine they have medical care also, free medical care. And there's a lot of power battles and structures among the upper crust of, and there's they're divided into hierarchies, like just like the Catholic Church would be the Pope, the cardinals, the bishops, the what do you call it, the big bishops. And, you know, the diocesan bishops and the ones that control large dioceses, and then the parish priests, and then the one that assists the parish priests, and all the way down. So there's same thing with the sadhus. It's the same thing. It's just they look exotic, and so we automatically assume that they know something. It's not true at all. Not true at all. I listened to videos of the Kumbh Mela interviewing a lot of these sadhus, and they're not, nothing profound really at all is being said. Nothing profound. Reciting the scriptures is not profundity at all. It's not fresh. It doesn't come from direct understanding, direct clarity. And it's a lifestyle. It's something there that is just part of society. Part of society. People go to them for blessings, essentially. You know, blessings for their children, blessings for their income, blessings for their housing, blessings for their family, blessings for all different types of things. They go, and the sadhus will recite some scripture and bless them, and people feel that they have some sort of power, like a spiritual power that they can convey to other people, to so people can have good fortune in their lives. Well, be as that may, that has nothing to do with enlightenment. It has nothing to do with salvation. Absolutely nothing. So I have yet to see the sadhus say anything about salvation, really. Really and truly. Do they really know bliss? Do they really know bliss? Okay. Or do they know scriptures? Same thing, like the Catholic Church. Does it really know bliss? Or the Christian Church, or any church, any religion, do they really know bliss? Do they actually know it? Do they really know it? Do they really know it? Or do they know scripture? Do they know dogma? You see, anybody can learn dogma, but to actually experience bliss, you're going to find yourselves on quite a road, quite a rocky road, and your intelligence has to be off the charts. It's a different type of intelligence. IQ doesn't get it done on the spiritual path. Yeah, you have to be beyond a genius, something different than genius, different than IQ. You have to be able to make certain differentiations that those with high IQs, geniuses, can't make at all. They're not even able to make it at all. So you have to have this tremendous intelligence of a certain type, that is capable of right distinction, right differentiation, determining what is true and what is not true, and being artful and continually utilizing this clarity to get past the obstacles and the defenses, etc., that are there, that the idols try to threaten and intimidate you. So it takes a different type of intelligence. Now, occasionally, throughout India, there are some who are enlightened, some who have some clarity. There are, but these run-of-the-mill sadhus, not necessarily at all. You know, they might call them armchair philosophers or something, and they do spiritual practices which are, you know, helpful, beneficial, but they certainly have this mystique. Or some people just feel very negative towards them, where an objective view is that it's somewhere in between, really. Somewhere in between. They're not bad people. I don't see the sadhus as being bad people at all. They just they seem to be fairly kindly, and they're attempting to find some answers. Hopefully they hope they can find some answers in some way. A lot of them are, you know, it's proscribed by the dogma, where the dogma tells them this is where you have to look and this is what you can get, and so they kind of accept their fate as it were, instead of rejecting all dogma and saying no, it's bliss or nothing, all right, because that's the truth, it's bliss or nothing. And you know, as much as people want to say that the ritual smoking hashish and using drugs like that are part of their rituals, etc., that's no way to go about it at all. It's no way to go about it. Absolutely not. So we're not going to find the answer there. You don't find the answers by hanging out with sadhus. Okay, you just don't. Not even close. Not even close to it. So if we're waiting for, you know, India to show the way, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. What shows the way are those who actually realize bliss, who actually accept bliss. Those are the way showers. It's not a country that shows the way. It's not a people. It's not a nationality. It's not a dogma. It's not a religion that shows the way. You have to, we have to actually stand up and pass, get past the, you know, dweller on the threshold, the idols making their final plea to turn us away from bliss, which is what happened to me last night. It was like a final plea. It must mean I'm very, very threatening to idols. They feel that that this path is about ready to accept bliss, and they see that as absolute ruination. They got it upside down and backwards. And so you get hit with this desperate effort to save you, to save you from bliss. And no matter how clear you have it, this desperate effort on the part of idols can momentarily shake you up a little bit, which is what happened to me. Shook me up a bit. So, a lot of people went to India to try to pick up on some wisdom because they were tired of the dogma, the stale dogma of the West. But what they don't realize is that they just traded one stale dogma for another stale dogma. It's what they thought it wasn't stale because of all the exotic costumes, you know, and the smoking of the ganja and all of that stuff. They said, "Wow, this is fresh. This is vital. This is new." No, it's not fresh or vital or new. It's been going on for it's all it's it that itself is very stale dogma. The problem that spiritual seekers make oftentimes that the jet setters who trip around the world is they keep thinking that they're keeping it fresh by going to all these different cultures. And when it gets boring in India, they go to Japan. When it gets boring to Japan, they go down to South America. There, you know, from there, they go who knows where. But they keep moving around and they keep thinking that they're keeping it fresh, but what all they're doing is trading one stale dogma for another. For a little while, momentarily, they feel, oh, now I've got it. I've got the freshness that I need. Because it's exotic. It's different. They're not used to it. But the ones who are used to it, to them, it's just stale dogma. They're just going through the motions. They don't really have the true insight that is moving them past their own traditions. We all have to transcend our own traditions to get to bliss. Because bliss is not a tradition in the world. It is not. Bliss does not condition the world at all. It's not a tradition. So we have to get by all traditions. And we can't just keep changing traditions, thinking that we're staying fresh and we're making progress on the path. We're not. We're just standing still. So Westerners, I see them going over to India and they get into the whole situation there, even adopt the garb and become sadhus, and they're just mumbling the same old rituals that the sadhus have done for ages, and this just becomes a lifestyle, and it's just like an exotic, eccentric lifestyle for them. They think, hey, at least I'm not stuck in the dogma of the Western world, which was so boring, but they're now stuck in the boring dogma of the Eastern world. That's a fact. But we're all a little vulnerable to that, of thinking, hey, if I just, the grass is always greener, if I just go over here, boy, I'm really going to get it. I'm going to break free of the bonds that hold me here, this sterile, futile, stale dogma that's been passed down. You know, bliss doesn't get passed down like that. It doesn't condition the world. It doesn't change the world. It doesn't do anything to the world. It just says it's showing the total non-judgment upon the world, upon everything, forever. Eternal non-judgment upon the world. Eternal non-judgment. And then when we turn that into some kind of, try to turn into religion, we make it judgment and say, oh, and then it's no longer bliss. See, we it's easy to lose sight of bliss in this world, very easy. You really have to have living examples of bliss in this world. Very important. So that you at least can tell the difference between dogma and bliss. There can be dogma about bliss, but that's not the bliss. That's not it. It's not insight. It's not seeing it. It's not recognizing it. It's not accepting it. It's trying to substitute something for it. It's placing it in the future. So one might say with the sadhus, you know, there's nothing to see here. Time to move on. There's nothing to see here. So there's our little foray into the exotic world of the sadhus. And they've got their little drums and their little rituals and things like that. But again, we just because we don't know what they are doesn't mean that they're somehow profound. But we hope they are. We hope. because we're so tired of our rituals here. So, you know, isn't there some ritual somewhere that's profound? So you see someone shaking a drum like that, and you say, oh, wow, they're drumming up something. Wow, they're drumming up some power, or what's going on? And so you think, wow, this is really, maybe this is profound. And the food they eat, the rituals, the fire ceremonies, all this stuff, you think, wow, maybe that's it. Bliss is not engaged in rituals. It doesn't engage in rituals. It's abiding in itself, in the eternal non-judgment of God upon all what-ifs, all things. Things are what-ifs. So when you look at a tree, it's not really a tree. It's a what-if there were such a thing as this tree that was impermanent. Because, of course, everything you're looking at is impermanent. So essentially what you're looking at, all perception shows you, what if there were impermanence? That is essentially what you are looking at, is impermanence. Everything. All right? It's a what if. There's no impermanent in reality at all. None. It's impossible. Everything that life, God creates, is permanent. It is. It will never be, isn't. It always is. It will always remain. So impermanence is a hypothetical. It's saying, what if it were possible? What if impermanence were possible? And then we've concocted this massive, massive staging of imagination, so we can look at this tree and say, well, what if there was impermanence in the form of a tree, of this tree? Say, what if there were impermanence in the form of this this plant? What if there were impermanence in the form of this table? What if there were impermanence in the form of this screen? So our desire to see what-ifs projects the what-ifs outward, externalizes them, and we experience them out there as form. What bliss is, what God did is just say, there's no reason to judge impermanence because it can never happen. So what need is there to judge what can never be? There's no need at all. So he just said, no judgment on what-ifs, none. I give no judgment, eternal non-judgment upon all what-ifs, equally, regardless of form of what if there could be this impermanence in the form of this tree, this lake, the sky, this planet, whatever. God says it's not necessary to judge any of that, because it just say impermanence can never be. So there's no need to judge a different what if impermanence in this particular form. It's unnecessary. God gives one blanket judgment to all forms of what if impermanence. All forms. Doesn't draw any distinction whatsoever. Just a blanket blessing of non-judgment, eternal non-judgment upon all form. And that is experienced by us, symbolizes itself as bliss, which is unconditional. Unconditioned, in other words, is not saying I have bliss now, but later I won't, or before I didn't, or I have these everything around me is blissful, but over there it's not blissful. No. No, bliss is a steady, unconditioned, blanket state of mind that sees everything as bliss. God's perfect and eternal not judgment upon this computer is bliss. God's eternal and perfect non-judgment upon this table is bliss. God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon this light is bliss. God's perfect and eternal judgment upon this body is bliss. God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon this chair, the seat, is bliss. God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon this air here is bliss. God's perfect and eternal judgment upon this time, this moment, is bliss. God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon this world is bliss. Upon this dirt is bliss. Upon this concrete is bliss. Upon this space here, God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon this space here is bliss. Upon this breath, God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon this breath is bliss. So you can use this affirmation to every single thing that you're aware of. You can say, God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon this ... upon this place is bliss, and start to practice that, and then you're going to be tuning yourself into bliss. Actually, you're getting ready for it, and this is how you can begin to diminish the anxiety, if that's possible. Right now I'm still struggling to find the way through that, but this certainly has to help. So we're literally defining bliss, and we're getting so close to saying, okay, yeah. So this bliss is God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all, upon everything, upon our breath, upon our life, upon our house, upon our neighborhood, upon our town, city, state, upon our country, upon the world, upon the solar system, the sun, upon this galaxy, upon the universe. There's God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all of it, all impermanence. And the very notion of impermanence, from the very beginning, concurrent, God's perfect non-judgment is eternal and perfect. Non-judgment is upon that. That is upon that. Whatever form that arises in, that imagined hypothetical impermanence, concurrent is God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon that. So, now let us take a view to another video here. This is the if we can see this. These are pictures of Texas oil fields back in the day, and they're just absolute amazing. The amazing scenery. Just check this out. I mean, it just blew my mind. I had no idea that this was Texas. I mean, this is the oil fields back in the day. They just absolutely were drilling like crazy. You stake a claim, and you get the land, and then you throw up this derrick, oil derrick, and then you start drilling, and then start pumping the crude up. So it was, as we're looking at this, we can remember that now is concurrent with time. now is concurrent with time. That means God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all what-ifs is concurrent with all what-ifs. It's concurrent with all what-ifs. It's always been concurrent, not before and not after. It's always concurrent. So there's no gap. The same instant we decided we're going to entertain what-ifs, at the same instant God said, decreed that he has no judgment. God has eternal non-judgment upon all what-ifs. Eternal non-judgment upon all what-ifs. And that's bliss. And that bliss, it symbolizes in what-ifs as bliss. And that bliss solves the continuity issue. Because God knew the only issue is a continuity issue. How do we stop what-ifs? How do we set down all what-ifs? Well, we get a reflection of reality, which is, of course, reality doesn't judge has no reason to judge itself either. So having no judgment of what-ifs whatsoever is very similar to reality, and that provides then the continuity, sense of continuity. See, these are panoramic pictures from the oil fields, and even though these are different pictures hooked up one after the other, there is a sense of continuity with the pictures, right? Because the pictures are pictures of similar landscape. So you're seeing different panoramas here, different places in Texas, and yet they seem kind of like, almost like one flowing landscape, right? So that's called a sense of continuity. All right, this is a great example, this video here. If you take a look at this video, many of the pictures have this, you know, you get a feeling like there's continuity. You're not upset by the fact that there's different slides or different photos one after the other. Your mind kind of says, hey, this all looks very similar, similar, so it's smooth. There's no extreme breaks in continuity, even though there are different pictures here. Whereas if, let's say, you threw in a picture of a sadhu from the previous video, right in the midst of this, right, that would be called a severe break in continuity. So here you are paying attention to the Texas oil fields, okay, and we'll actually do this little experiment here. Paying attention to the Texas oil fields. Let me see. And suddenly you get from a derrick, oil derrick, to okay. We suddenly get a sadhu like this. All right. That's a break in continuity, right? It's not horizontal. It's like vertical, and you get this exotic sadhu. The oil fields. It's a little slow to total break in continuity, right? Severe break in continuity. Now look at these pictures of the oil fields, and these are different pictures, just like a sadhu. The picture of the sadhu is a different picture, but these pictures are similar. So there's not really a break of continuity. You get the different feeling from this. Very important. This is what I'm talking about in a sense of continuity. Is you just feel like, hey, I got no problem seeing these different pictures here. I feel calm. I feel smooth. It feels integrated. It feels continuous. The sense of continuity here, even though these are different pictures from different photographers in different areas of Texas. The content is similar. They all have these derricks. They all have this kind of a flat landscape. And they've got these oil rigs. They all have the oil rigs. And so you say, hey, you know, it all, so it's amazing, right? Let's do another test on a break of continuity. So you're looking at these here, and you're so used to these oil rigs, and then suddenly, whoom, you know, that, what? What is that? It's a shock, isn't it? Do you get that sense of a continuity break? Absolutely. Say, whoa, this is completely different. And so now we're back, and then we're feeling a continuity with these pictures. So when you ask, okay, what is a sense of continuity? This is just kind of an example that we've just given. of a sense of continuity. So bliss gives us a sense of continuity back to no hypotheticals at all, no impermanence, which is a hypothetical. What if it was? What if this were possible? What if impermanence were possible? Eventually, we have to set that down. So how do we go from setting that down to reality, to no impermanence? By bliss, by experiencing a blanket experience where everything that we are experiencing is, we feel, is the same, has the same quality of perfect non-judgment, perfect and eternal non-judgment, resting upon all equally. That is like a mirror to reality. It has so much similarity to reality that then we can move right smoothly into reality. Piece of cake, piece of cake. But without that bliss, then you have a jarring sense of jarring continuity issue. How do you leap straight from totally identifying with impermanence to no impermanence whatsoever and no possibility that could ever possibly be any? That's like, you know, shock, some kind of shock, it would seem like. And you might get all nervous and say, "Whoa, wait a minute! This is where's the continuity? This is scary." So, bliss is the goal. Bliss is the goal. God's perfect non-judgment, perfect and eternal. I mean, it's always there. God's concurrent, perfect and eternal non-judgment upon this is bliss. Upon existence is bliss. You can be both general and specific. Upon this watch, you can say God's concurrent, perfect, and eternal non-judgment upon this watch is bliss. So when you look at the watch, you're not seeing the watch, you're seeing bliss. You're seeing the blissful watch, as it were, the blissful computer, the blissful air, the blissful breath, the blissful sight, the blissful scene, the blissful landscape. It's all the same. Blissfulness. That is the goal, and that is a goal that can be reached. That is a goal we must reach, and that is the goal we will reach. So now let us go look at another type of video here. Yet it's okay, here we go. So what I did was I made the transitions between these figures. See if we can't get at least what kind of sense of continuity here. How do we feel about this? Now is concurrent with time. And if you look at this, enough bodies, you say, wow, even though all the bodies are different, they're all pretty much the same, aren't they? Pretty much the same. They're variations. And you can say that each one, the concurrent, perfect, and eternal blessing of non-judgment upon this body is bliss. And then they say the concurrent, perfect, and eternal blessing of non-judgment upon all bodies is bliss. Each and every one, no judgment upon any bodies, no thing, no judgment upon any things. Concurrent, perfect, and eternal blessing of non-judgment upon this body, the concurrent, perfect, and eternal blessing of non-judgment upon this body. The concurrent, perfect, and eternal blessing of non-judgment upon this body is bliss. The concurrent, perfect, and eternal blessing of non-judgment upon this body is bliss. Now is concurrent with time, the bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time, the concurrent, perfect, and blissful blessing of non-judgment is mine. Or now is concurrent with time, the bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time, the bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time, the bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time, the bliss of non-judgment is mine. And you start to see, like, hey, all these bodies, it's just like one body, isn't it? Just kind of morphing. It's kind of like, what if impermanence could be bodies? What if there were impermanent bodies? What if there could be impermanence in the form of bodies? And they say, well, what if there could be impermanence in the form of bodies, and these bodies could all vary a little bit from one another? See, but it's all just the same idea. What if there could be what if there could be impermanence in the form of this human body, this biped, biped form we call human form, the human meat suit? What if there could be impermanence in this form? And then God would says, well, the concurrent, perfect, and the concurrent, perfect, and eternal blessing of non-judgment upon this body is bliss. Upon all bodies is bliss. Upon all forms of impermanence is bliss. The perfect, the concurrent, perfect, and eternal blessing of non-judgment upon all things is bliss. So you cannot see one thing as blissful and something else is not. That's impossible. You either see everything as blissful or you see nothing as blissful. Because bliss is the concurrent and perfect eternal blessing of non-judgment upon all what-ifs. All of them, without regard to the form of the what-if. So you either see everything as in its blissful form, or you see nothing in its blissful form. So you can tell. You can tell who's in bliss and who is not easily. Easily. So, having affection for something, you know, people try to have affection for their teacher, affection for this, and they try to have a lot of affection for something. That's not bliss. The ones in bliss, you can tell that everything is blissful to them. They're seeing everything in its blissful nature, which comes directly from the concurrent and perfect and eternal blessing of non-judgment upon all what-ifs, equally, forever and forever. No matter what form we come up with impermanence, so what if impermanence in this form, what if we could do what-ifs forever and a day, and the perfect, the concurrent perfect and eternal blessing of God's non-judgment is upon that. Concurrently is upon that. It's always been upon it. Because what-ifs don't touch reality. They don't do anything to reality. Can never cause any change in reality whatsoever. They have no power. Since therefore, they're really nothing. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment. I like that one. Look at that. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now, of course, speaking of course, let us talk about A Course in Miracles, because A Course in Miracles stresses forgiveness. And you wonder, why is that so important? Well, we've just said that you either see everything as blissful in its blissful nature or nothing. So if you have enemies, how can you experience bliss? Because you won't want to see them in their blissful nature. You want to see your friends as blissful and your enemies as miserable. It's impossible. God makes no distinction among what-ifs. None. Okay, and that's bliss. So the non-judgment is upon all equally. And for some reasons we tend to struggle with that because issues of incompetence. We want to see others as they're the bad guys. They're incompetent. I'm not. Fear of all this fear engenders this insecurity. So we don't want to see everyone as in their blissful nature. So that's the struggle. So A Course in Miracles is pointing towards bliss, and it emphasizes forgiveness as a very practical focus, something that I believe the Western world has focused on through Christianity, trying to forgive others. But it goes way beyond forgiving others, really. Really, that's just kind of baby steps. It really is forgiving ourselves for what ifs. How do we forgive ourselves for what ifing? By accepting bliss. That's how we forgive ourselves. And we experience then everything in its blissful nature, which then solves the continuity issue. We say, not a problem to drop what ifs altogether at that point. How are we doing? Going up towards an hour. Amazing. How's it going, everybody? This is a new format, kind of, and it seems to be working pretty well. Other than the videos are a little slow, but I'll go back to. Something that's very important right now. We tend to, what I find is a lot of people in the West kind of look up to the East and think that the East must have the answers. And so they sell themselves short. And they think, oh, this person has ash smeared on their forehead. They must know the answer. But I tell you this, that there have been many in the West who have actually realized bliss. And we don't have to take a backseat to anyone. The West doesn't have to take a backseat to the East, and the East doesn't have to take a backseat to the West. And we can do it right here, right now. We don't need to be smearing ash on ourselves. And concurrently, the sadhus don't have to be dressed up in Nike gear either, you know. But we can, and it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It has nothing to do with it. External appearance has nothing to do with it. Hey. And chanting various exotic stuff, you know, can have something to do with it or doesn't have to. You can do it your own way. We can do it now as concurrent with time. The bliss of God is mine. That's a Maha Mantra. That is a Maha Mantra. I mean, see, the East have all these mantras, and we think, oh, I need to go to the East to get a mantra. No, we don't have to go to the East to get a mantra. We didn't use our own mantras. Our own we call them affirmations. They call them mantras. Same thing. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of God is mine. That's a Maha Mantra. That has profound effect, profoundly helpful effect. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of God, the bliss of non-judgment is mine. What's going on? There's a lot of activity here. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of God is mine. Bliss of non-judgment is mine. So, it's very important. Don't be intimidated by other traditions, by traditions at all. Don't be hostile to them. I'm not hostile at all to them. I respect them. I enjoy them. But don't be intimidated. Don't think you need to follow their lead. You have to wait for them to lead. You have to follow, etc. No, no way. Bliss is bliss. Bliss is God's concurrent, perfect, eternal non-judgment upon all of us. That's what bliss is, and bliss solves the continuity issue entirely. And that's it. That's all we need to know. We just need to get to bliss. That's it. That's it. And you can do that right where you are. By accepting this non-judgment upon all things equally, and practicing affirmations is very, very helpful. Listening to explanations is very, very helpful. They call these holy men, holy men. Well, what makes you holy is bliss, because bliss is holy upon everything. It's God's non-concurrent, perfect, and eternal non-judgment upon everything, every what if, every form of impermanence. So it's whole, it's entire. It's not fragmented, it's not partial. So that's what the term holy means, entire, not fragmented, not partial. So when you, once you have the vision of bliss, people call it the vision of Christ, the vision of oneness, all this, the vision of bliss. Once you have bliss, then you are having the holy vision, the vision of holiness, of wholeness. And people will say, well, you're a saint, you're a holy person, et cetera, et cetera. They give various terms of that. But just being an aspirant, that doesn't make you a holy person. It does not. You can be sitting in a lotus posture chanting for the rest of your life. That's not necessarily going to get it done. It might or it might not. It depends on the Holy Spirit inviting. If you follow the Holy Spirit's advice, it will fashion a path for you which is effective for you. And paths can vary widely, extremely. There is no one set path that you say, well, this is the way to do it. No way. No way. I mean, if somebody looked at my path, they would say, look, it's got absolutely nothing to do with enlightenment. How can you possibly reach it this way? they'd just say, like, this is impossible. What are you talking about? Crazy. No way. But for me, it's been absolutely relevant, totally relevant. I understand the wisdom of it. Overwhelming my value of the world. Lots of things the Holy Spirit has done to help me out. And it's been, you know, effective for me. But for someone else, they wouldn't see it that way. So you don't judge others' past so much. It's effectiveness that counts. So you cannot prescribe, make a prescription for everybody saying, this is what you need to do. You need to wear these clothes, do this, do this, do that, and say this and that. Not necessarily. There can be overlap, sure. I mean, there can be certain things that are helpful in most cases. That is true. Using affirmations can be very, very helpful. Clarification, satsang is very, very helpful. So there's lots of overlap. But again, each one's path is unique. So don't sell yourself short. Don't sell yourself short just because your path is not the same as somebody else's. But bliss is the same for everyone. That is the same for everyone. It's not experienced differently. It's the same because it's entire. It's seamless. It's seamless. And there's perfect non-judgment, perfect concurrent, perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all things, all forms of impermanence, including this air, including the space, including the time, space and time, everything in space and time, all concurrent, perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all of that. And once we experience that, our fears are gone, because you're seeing the delight. There's a delight to it. That's what they tell us. Those who have experienced it, they say it's very peaceful, and there's no fear there. And there's sort of a gentleness to it, that transcends anything we understand about gentleness. There's no force being applied. There's no trickery being applied either. No subtlety, and no force, no subtlety being applied. It's not neither subtle nor non-subtle, which is why they use all these terms, neither this nor that, neither this nor that, because it's not anything conditioned at all. People also call it nirvana. That's also what it is, nirvana. You enter nirvana, not moving, means not moving, meaning this God's concurrent, perfect, and eternal non-judgment about all things. It's not moving trying to get somewhere. It's not nature moving. It's not impermanent. It rests upon all equally, softly, gently, without any motion at all. So nirvana, without movement. So yeah, nirvana is another term. I think the Buddhists use that term. that's the goal. You can say the goal is nirvana. Others call it enlightenment, salvation. It's all the same. It's all the same. So can we reach nirvana? Absolutely, we can reach nirvana. Can we do it while we're here? Absolutely, that's when we're supposed to do it. So, nirvana, here we come. Here we come. So we can say let's go to the this video just checked out. Okay. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of nirvana is mine. See, now is concurrent with time. The bliss of nirvana is mine. Because nirvana is exactly the same as salvation, vision of oneness, vision of Christ, bliss. Nirvana is bliss. But we can say that now is concurrent with time. The bliss of nirvana is mine. Or nirvana is mine. Either way, now is concurrent with time. The bliss of nirvana is mine. Because we think nirvana is something different. It's not. It's just people use different terms. They describe it. They say, this. And someone asks them, what is this bliss like? And they say, well, there's no movement. It's without movement, meaning nirvana, without movement. So they say, well, it's a state of mind where there's no movement, where it's peace beyond. Jesus said, peace beyond understanding. It's the same thing, no movement, nirvana. So this state of mind is, the nirvanic state of mind is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The nirvanic state of mind is mine. Okay? Now is concurrent with time. The nirvanic state of mind is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The nirvanic non-judgment is mine. Nirvanic non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. Nirvanic non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. Nirvanic non-judgment is mine. But we get freaked out by these Eastern terms, and it throws us off, you know. Throws us off. Like, samadhi, you know, entered samadhi. There's another term, samadhi. Same thing, samadhi, nirvana, bliss, all the same. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of samadhi is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of samadhi is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of samadhi is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The non-judgment of samadhi is mine. Perfect non-judgment of samadhi is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The non-judgment of samadhi is mine. The non-judgment of nirvana is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. So, we're all talking about the same thing. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of samadhi is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of nirvana is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of oneness is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of salvation is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of oneness is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of samadhi is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of vision is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of nirvana is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of forgiveness is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of samadhi is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of samadhi is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of salvation is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of Christ is mine. Now is concurrent with time, Krishna consciousness is mine. Now is concurrent with time, Christ consciousness is mine. Now is concurrent with time. Samadhi is mine. Now is concurrent with time. Nirvana is mine. The bliss of Nirvana is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of Christ consciousness is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of Christ's vision is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of oneness is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of vision is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of forgiveness is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of Nirvana is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of oneness is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of salvation is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of Nirvana is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of realization is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of enlightenment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of vision is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of now is mine. There's another one, now. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of oneness is mine. So, there you go. You can practice this. It's very powerful to break down these artificial barriers of mysticism and mystique. The mystique of realization, the mystique of vision, Christ consciousness, Krishna consciousness, samadhi, oneness, forgiveness, salvation, nirvana, the mystique of all of that. You know, break it down, get past this mystique. We have to get past the mystique of it all here. It's all the same thing. It's God's perfect non-judgment upon what ifs. God's perfect non-judgment upon what ifs is the case for all what ifs, for all aspects of spirit. It's the same for all. God doesn't have some different plan for different aspects of spirit. It's all one non-judgment, perfect, eternal, concurrent non-judgment upon all what ifs. Whatever form of impermanence we dream up, imagine, hypothesize, God's concurrent, perfect, and eternal non-judgment rests upon that, as well as all others concurrently. It's not a process, it's concurrent. The resting upon all is from the very beginning, and it remains there eternally. So it's always concurrently resting upon all. Always concurrently resting upon all. So you can't see that one, that over there, as blissful, and then that over there is not. It's not possible. But you're seeing, if you see that, you're seeing your affection for something. It's not bliss. It's not salvation. It's not nirvana. It's not samadhi. It's not Christ consciousness. It's not the vision of oneness. It's not the peace beyond understanding. It's not forgiveness. It's not any of that stuff. It's still us wifing. Like, what if I could have bliss for that and not for that? Because what if this was permanent and this wasn't, but this was impermanent? What's that? That's what ifing. Because in reality, there's no impermanence at all. So to say that there's some impermanence is what ifing. So if we say, well, I want this to be permanent. What if this was permanent and what if this wasn't? So what if I had bliss for this but not for this? Not possible. Not possible. So, again, of course, the miracles say forgiveness for everything. Don't make any exceptions for forgiveness. That's all important. That's leading one way to go towards bliss. One way to emphasize, which is some people like that. There's lots of other ways. Lots of other ways. Thousands of other ways. This collapse is still, it's still there. So there's no problem talking about this, but physically, I feel like, boom, like physically the body's like getting ready to drop away. Drop. That's not good. So it's a struggle here. I imagine other people are having struggles right now, actually. I can't imagine how they're not, really. Because the drums, boom, 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 you know. The natives are restless, the drums are pounding. And, you know, a coup is coming, so to speak. It's like in the Central Republic of Congo, Central Republic of Congo, something like that. And, you know, here comes the coup, you know, here comes the coup. Here comes the new warlord coming in. The other warlord, phew, get out of Dodge, go over to somewhere else, Zimbabwe or whatever they go to. Take refuge. Take refuge as the coup comes in. Need to take refuge, of course. You know, they know what's coming. They get out of Dodge. Because they know, uh-oh, here comes the coup. Time to flee. So what do we do? We flee into Bliss. Bliss is the sanctuary. Bliss is the refuge. And those who are willing to flee into the refuge of Bliss, they get help, they get help, they get help, and there may be relocation efforts on their behalf to get them out of harm's way, get them out of Dodge, get them out of the Central African Republic of the Congo, which, let's face it, the world's a jungle. All the world's a jungle. Let's not kid ourselves. We may live in an urban jungle, it's still the jungle. We may live in a bureaucratic jungle, but that's the worst kind of jungle at all, I'll tell you the truth. I mean, most of us would kind of long for some African jungle compared to this bureaucratic nightmare jungle that we're in now. My gosh, they're making life unpalatable, except for, you know, tech junkies. I say, oh good, more bureaucracy? Hey, here's 20 apps to help me deal with that bureaucracy, and I can manipulate my way around. I can win. Because I'm quicker with apps and everything. I'm more clever. But most people say, hey, I don't want to waste my time with that. I want Bliss. I don't want to win. I want Bliss. I don't want to triumph. I want Bliss. I don't want a victory, triumph, conquering. I don't want to conquer. I don't want to outdo. I don't want to compete. I don't want to, you know, all the stuff. I just want Bliss. I want Bliss. I don't want this all-encompassing octopus of alphabet soup of all this bureaucracy just, you know, strangling us. For me, it's just like, it's enough. Forget it. Enough's enough. Enough's enough. I don't want this stuff. I'm out of here. Which is why we love the sadhus, isn't it? Because they seem to be unentangled in bureaucracy. But the fact is they're entangled in their own internal bureaucracies, which is why the Kumbh Mela tries to iron out those problems. Now, Ananda Mahima used to go to the Kumbh Mela. I think she went to what, about, I don't know, 7, maybe 8 of them. And she helped them iron out their problems. Because the leaders of all these, there's like, well, 7 different major sects that come to the Kumbh Mela, and they have a bathing order. There's all these protocol, you know, protocol is super important, super important. They fight wars and battles over protocol. And there's all these disagreements of who the successor shall be and the voting and all these things. Oh man, there's so many disagreements. And so sometimes it gets real bad. And so she would have her tent, her area there, her pandal, and she'd invite the leaders of these contentious factions who just were so angry to say, no, we're the original one. We should go second or bathing first. We have the most seniority, and there's all these adolescent squabbles, you know. She'd invite all of them into her tent, and she'd just sit there and hang out with them, and mostly in silence. And she might, some pleasantries and niceties, and just hang out. And after a while, they'd be feeling this overwhelming bliss just radiating from her. And they get this contact high from the bliss. And they'd completely forget what they were arguing about. Now, this is very true. Observers observed this and wrote about it. And by the time they'd get out of the tent, they were pranaming each other, saying, best of dear friends, they had no idea what they could ever possibly disagreed on. And that would last for like a couple of weeks or something. But they're completely gone. That's the effect that bliss can have, but it's temporary. It's temporary. Then, of course, go right back to the disagreements that arise again. And And so it's kind of like a futile thing. It's like rolling a stone up a hill. And if you don't really get down to the nitty gritty, then you're just rolling a stone up a hill, trying to help people that way. Got to get down to the nitty gritty. But of course, the gurus, the real ones, the blissful ones, do get down to the nitty gritty. But people do have the contact highs. That helps a little bit. But if you don't get down to the nitty gritty, then it wears off. Wears off. It's like a painkiller. Wears off. Then what do you got to do? You got to ice it. It hurts. It hurts. It hurts. And so. But I think she did it for the sake of having the Kumbh Mela go smoothly, for the sake of those who were there for a really spiritual focus, is to stop the squabbling so everything could go well. So there was an overall benefit from it. So there you go. We're at a time of extreme anxiety, extreme pressure. The Supreme Court is going to rule pretty soon on Defensive Marriage Act and all that stuff. And there's another whopper. There's another big whopper trying to fundamentally re-engineer society. Fundamentally re-engineer society. And that's a super, super divisive thing. And it's something to get people at each other's throats, and enmity causes this incredible enmity. All this is on purpose for people to feel like they're reached a state of complete paralysis of indecisiveness. I just don't know what to do. I have no, I can't function at all. And then here comes the savior of the bureaucratic New World Order leaders and say, we'll tell you what to think. We'll tell you what's right and what's wrong, and then you can start functioning again. So it's trying to freeze us up, trying to lock us up, freeze us up through these very, very, very divisive kind of situations. And so we're now in the thick of that, the thick of that. I dread the Supreme Court decision, no matter what it is. I absolutely dread it. Good Lord, that's just no matter what it is just going to kick off a firestorm, within people. Maybe everybody will probably be calm about it. Like Americans are very good at that, being calm. Most people are. You say that, okay, this is it, and say okay. We don't tend to go berserk or anything, but inside, at a deep level, people are going to have a tremendously severe reaction to it. Super divisive, like gun control. Super divisive, like many things. Many issues right now are super, super divisive. Healthcare is another nightmare, absolute nightmare. That's one that I actually feel more than the other issues. The other issues, I have some, reaction to them. But healthcare, for me, forget it. Forget it. You can't tell. It's a nightmare. Believe me, it is a nightmare. You're already getting unbelievable pressure from insurance companies telling doctors how they should practice medicine, and then passing it on to the patients in an attempt for insurance companies to save money and to function under this healthcare system. And you're just going to, holy cow, you're not going to get the treatment that you want. You're going to get less, and it is just, it's a fundamental violation of freedom, fundamental violation. And it's a nitty-gritty, that's a nitty-gritty one. If you don't want health care, you shouldn't be forced to have health care, period. But then you can see the other side of it too, like Christian Scientists, why should they be forced to have health care? Why should everybody? Of course, there are exceptions. There's all this bureaucracy and political, and it is just a gigantic nightmare that is coming upon us. Then you have the financial struggles, whether struggles between fractional reserve banking and non-reserve banking. What's it called? Well, non-fractional reserve banking. You have this enormous struggle in the world about how financial institutions are going to be set up. Incredibly divisive situation. You have capitalism and socialism. You have this a world that is so polarized on so many levels now that you're heading toward paralysis. The world's heading toward paralysis, which I experienced this morning. Could barely sit up, could barely move. I felt like almost like I don't dare move. You know, it's so, my whole frontal self, you know, was like locked up. And that's what we're headed to, and it's all by design. It's all by design. There is no reason to push all these things except us into a lockup state. And then we're so desperate, we're willing to turn to the dictator, you know, the Antichrist, instead of bliss. We could turn to bliss, right? We could turn to bliss, and we will. But many will not, because they're not prepared themselves for bliss. They don't have a clue. So there's a feeling of no continuity there. They say, oh, I can't just jump into something. I have no idea what it's about. But for us, we can say, oh, I know exactly what it's about. So it's no trouble at all. So it's basically bliss or the abyss. All right, it's either Christ or the Antichrist. So the Antichrist will say, oh, you can't function? Okay, we'll tell you how to function. This is how you're going to function. And people say, oh, thank you. And then they become robots. Essentially robots. And they become terrified of thinking for themselves because they feel that they're going to go back into that lockup condition, that extreme uncertainty. Extreme uncertainty. Like, I don't know what position to take. I'm so confused. They're afraid they're going to go back to that. So there's this extreme trauma that they will be so afraid of that they'll just say, no, I can't think for myself. I got to do what the leadership tells me to do so I can function. See? So that's called locking in a cycle. What that does is it starts a new cycle of hypotheticals. Another cycle. That's how it starts. And of course, if you don't want to start another cycle, you got to choose bliss. That's how you get out of all cycles, is bliss. So that's why thinking about this stuff, considering it, is super important. It is super important, and there's not many people doing it, apparently. I don't know how I can get more subscribers. Really, I'm not a marketer. That's not my purpose, to be a marketer, but I don't know how to. Certainly, I wish that there would be more people in the world who would be considering this, really directly considering it. It's bliss or the abyss, period. It's Christ or Antichrist, bliss or the abyss, freedom or roboticism. And that's coming up right now. It's here. Pressure is on. Big time pressure. You know, it's all happening at once, isn't it? That's why we're really getting at the squeeze. We got the defense of marriage ruling coming up. We've got the gun control issue coming to a head. We got the financial system meltdown and the tremendous disquiet around that. We got the capitalism versus socialism thing. And you go on and on and on and on and on in this world, and you have these big issues. You know, you have the religious the wars of atheists versus deists. I mean, that polarization. You have the polarization of Islam against modern decadent society. As they see it, and that's quite right. It's very decadent. You have the, these various big polarizations. You have the polarization of whether petrodollars will be based on dollars, or oil be based on petrodollars or euros or something else, or a global currency. Is oil going to be put onto some global currency, or is it still going to be on petrodollars? You have that. You know, it's a huge one that's behind the wars. All of this is coming to a head at the same time. All at the same time. So I've been warning you in years in advance that this is going to happen. It's going to happen all at once. It's all going to come to a head. To what? To freeze us up. To lock us up. To make us feel like we can't function. We can't decide. We don't know what to do. We're just overwhelmed by indecision. And then that's when we are prey to the demagogue. The demagogue. The dictator. The demagogue will get us going again. That's what happened in Germany. Germany was locked up. Everything came to a head. You had all these issues. Hyperinflation. Communists were trying to take over. You had super unemployment. You had super decadence. There is very decadent. Berlin was an incredibly decadent place. Every kind of vice was just spreading like a cancer throughout society, and the people were absolutely desperate, and they just didn't know what to do. They didn't know what to do. And they were just locked up, getting frozen up. You know, just like, we can't function. Along comes the demagogue and says, hey, I'll tell you exactly what to do. And here's what we're going to do. And this is what you're going to do. This is your role, and that's what you're going to do. And then people, at least they could get moving, but now they're moving like robots. I'm just following orders, you know. Mein Herren. No, I just followed orders, of course, because they were roboticized by the demagogue, because the situation was ripe for it. So the world is ripe now for a world demagogue, okay? A world demagogue. The world is going to be plunged into such a state of indecision, uncertainty, and frozenness, non-functionality, that easy for a demagogue to come onto the scene and say, don't worry, we'll tell you exactly what to do. They'll say, they are here, and they will assign roles to everybody. We got the technology, folks, we can do it, easy, no problem, we'll do it, let's get going. And they say, everyone says, okay. And they say, okay, now just get rid of them and that and that and that and that, and we've got to get rid of them and pull those weeds out, and let's tend our garden here, folks, get going. You know, just like in Germany. So that's what we're headed towards. But we in general, the world, but those who are wise have seen this coming. They're headed towards bliss. The freedom of bliss. Freedom of bliss. It's freedom because you already have what you want. You already have what you really want, which is bliss. And it's everywhere. So how can you lose it? So you're free to go anywhere, do anything. It's always with you. It's always with you. It's everywhere. So that's a certain reflection of freedom. Reflection of freedom. You can't lose it. You're free to go anywhere you want, and you always have this bliss with you. You don't need anyone to tell you what to do, because it's not dependent on doing. It's not dependent on place, on identity, on what your name is, or what your rank or serial number is. It's not dependent on your monetary status or what you do, your relationships. It's not dependent on anything like that. It's dependent on God. Bliss is dependent on God. God's concurrent, perfect, and eternal non-judgment upon all what-ifs is always been here. Always with what-ifs. Always will be. And we can accept that right this moment. Everyone can accept it right this moment. Don't have to go accept a robotic role under the directions of a demagogue and one world dictator and its bureaucracy. The bureaucracy and its councils and endless courts and, you know, like that EU's got all this stuff set up. You know, I think the EU is kind of like a test case for the one world government, really. So many commissions and things like that, where they get people from all these different countries together, and then they decide how to run all the countries of the world, what's going to be the marching orders for everybody. But of course, the one thing they leave out is what? Bliss. They leave that out. They leave salvation out. Because again, salvation, each one has their own path, right? You need freedom for that. You need a place of where the sadhus have been free for a long time to live their own life. If they want to go for bliss, they can go for it. In America, we've had certain freedoms that have helped us, helped us go towards bliss too. But now it can feel, the winds of change are blowing, and all that is going to be gone with the wind. Gone with the wind. No wonder why people are trying to hang out in Goa, or trying to find some place in the Himalayas, or where can we get away from this? Where can we be free to spend our time the way we want to spend our time? If we don't want health care, we don't have to work to get health care. We don't have to be part of the system. We don't have to be chipped. We don't have to be all the stuff they're looking for. Where can we go? Where can we go? Well, why do we only look on planet? Why not off planet? Who's to say, right? Why not look off planet? Why not? People are only looking horizontally. Look vertically. Look vertically too. Look vertically too. But in the meantime, work on bliss. Work on bliss. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of nirvana is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of salvation is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. It is mine. It is mine. Because it's everywhere. So if it's everywhere, how could it not be mine? Where is it not mine? You see, by extending it, bliss is extended to all, by saying it rests upon everything. So where could I find where it's not? I can't find where it's not. So how could I not have it? Where could I be where I could not have it? So we must have it. If it's everywhere, without any exception, we must have it too, right? So that's why Jesus says, first you extend it, accept the extension to everywhere, and then you will realize that you too have it. Because you've given. Giving in reality is to all. And so if you give to all, you must also, you must have it. You must be aware of it, because there's no place where it isn't. And you're part of the all. You're part of the all. And as far as bliss, if everything we are aware of is radiating blissfulness to us, certainly, see, our awareness would be filled with blissfulness. Awareness filled with blissfulness. Now is concurrent with time. Blissful awareness is mine. Now is concurrent with time. Blissful awareness is mine. So I hope this has helped you out. Has helped me out. We'll see how it goes in the days ahead. Hopefully I have a blissful dream tonight. Other than, certainly don't want the one I had last night. I'll tell you that. So, now is concurrent with time. Blissful awareness is mine. Now is concurrent with time. God's non-judgment. The bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. Blissful awareness is mine. Blissful awareness is mine. So, we've covered a lot of super important territory here. It's been a really great one. Enjoyed it. And we'll keep on trucking. Keep on trucking. But quickly. But quickly, right? But quickly. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.